First of all, let me both welcome Professor Prakash Vaidya and thank him for agreeing to take this session. But what I wanted to tell you is that you are all familiar with our typical Indian weakness in written articulation. We are very good at talking, typically in our mother tongue or in some kind of English which the other person understands, but it is not necessarily correctly spoken. And most certainly it is not correctly written. And as professionals, if we make a mistake in writing a Java program or C++ program, there is a fellow called compiler who catches it. If we make a mistake in writing English, in spite of the word processing capabilities, not every time things are caught. Some spelling mistakes are not caught, grammatical roots are not caught, and even if they are caught, they are not necessarily attempted to be corrected with great seriousness that it deserves. So this is where we felt that we should have some of these issues addressed. This is by no means a full-fledged course or something. This is just a glimpse. The idea is twofold. The specific things that Professor Vaidya will discuss should be adapted and practiced. But it should be a pointer to you to look at similar other issues, and there are large numbers. Prescribe that everybody should read correct English writing and proof editing. This is the material. This is not a new book. The original one was written, I think, about 150 years ago, and since then it has been updated. And sadly, in our engineering and science curriculum, none of this is considered important. Because presumably in your school you have learnt language. The kind of language people learn is unfortunately not adequate for proper written articulation. So it is absolutely essential that we practice this. Many of you have written documentation, technical documentation and user documentation. User documentation, I mean, forget the syntax part which this will help you, but even the semantics and the way you put together your thoughts leaves a lot to be desired. And one reason why this happens is that when we read good text or good manuals, we do not try to write something on those lines to try and express ourselves better. Basically, we spend very little quality time of our brain on the act of writing text in whichever language. And I think I would like you to take this opportunity to start afresh. All of us whose native language is not English would necessarily make more mistakes than what would be expected ordinarily. My contention is that people who make such mistakes in English invariably also make greater mistakes when they write in their native mother tongue also. You try doing that. Try write 10 sentences in English. Try write the same 10 sentences in Hindi or Gujarati or Tamil or whatever is your mother tongue. And I can bet that any day you will make same number of mistakes in your mother tongue. The problem is that you have not applied your mind with discipline to the act of writing. And that is what I would like you to do. There is a certain discipline when you write even a paragraph. Minimally, you must read that paragraph yourself, check for errors. And maximally, you should get that paragraph read by a friend with criticality and get things corrected before you say this paragraph is fine. Now, this habit is as important as the habit of testing your own programs, trying and testing. So, that is the only thing I wanted to convey. Enjoy this session. Thank you, Prakash, once again, and all the best.
Welcome, everybody. Dr. Phatak has already given you an introduction of what the problem is which we are trying to solve. So, first problem is whether there is a problem. In quality control, whenever a quality control engineer goes to a industrial plant and asks, do you have quality problems? They say, no, we do not have quality problems. Maybe other industries have, but our industry is perfect. So, first problem is to recognize that we have a problem. There is a visual disorder called diplopia that That is, sometimes you can't focus and you see double images, which even happens to ordinary people. So one boy was having this problem, but he was not aware of that. So his father told him that, son, you see double. Son said, how is it possible? If that were so, then in the sky I would have seen four moons instead of two. Okay, you are already seeing two moons in the sky, and he was thinking that it was normal. So that is the situation in which we are. That when we write or when we read, there are many hidden errors which pass by us. We are not aware of them, so we don't feel anything wrong. So these sessions have been organized to make us aware of these things, where we will be seeing the basics of proofreading and what kind of marks are used for proofreading and what references to have. So we will have a handout which is already there with everybody, I think, which we will be studying in the first session. Then we will have a second session where we will have an exercise. So we will use these marks to do the exercise. It is an open book exam. You can refer to this sheet. You can use all these marks and try to do the exercise. Then we will review the exercise together in the class, and then we will see how much we have caught up and where we may be lacking. This will be today's second session. Then we will also discuss, when you go back, how you can use this knowledge and what is the procedure to be adopted, how to do it in pairs or in a group, etc. That we will discuss later on, so that you can utilize this knowledge throughout your life. It is not only while you are in IIT or while you are working on a project. What knowledge you are gaining is so fundamental, it will be useful throughout your life in whatever undertaking you do. So this proof editing is not really taught as a subject in any of the courses except journalism. Even in English courses also, proof editing etc. is not considered very important. Maybe grammar is, but not proof editing. But in journalism, it is considered important. So in a journalistic class, whenever a student submits an assignment, the instructor first does proof editing and gives it back, saying that you correct all this so that there are no grammatical errors, and then only I will see the content. He does not look at the content before checking the form. And in doing an assignment and checking it, more than half the time is spent on proofreading. Content checking actually takes much less time. So you can imagine, if somebody really gives a assignment which does not require much proofreading, then instructor's job is simplified. So even with students who are going to be professionals, even they make mistakes and they learn it the hard way. So since we are amateurs, because our actual field of working is not journalism or writing, so we are excused even if we are doing mistakes just now, but we are not excused from not correcting them. So we will be learning how to detect mistakes and how to mark them and how to correct them. Typically, those of you who have done some publishing work, even at our end, you will find that the manuscript or typescript, whatever, keeps on going to and fro from the author to the final editor, and it goes on many times. Typically, at least four times the script is handled till it becomes publishable. And in a large book, this goes on up to 10 times till the final book is ready for publication. So we should not be disheartened by repeated markings by others and having to correct them, etc. It is part of the game. It always happens like this. But we should not stop till the errors become undetectable or almost zero. So how long does it take to check a page? For reading a page, maybe it takes a few minutes. you want to read an A4 page. For proofreading an A4 page, it takes 20 minutes, which is many times the time you require for ordinary reading. So, it is no wonder that during ordinary reading we cannot find errors, because unless you look for them, the errors will miss you. So, it takes lot of effort and we should be prepared for that. Incidentally, 20 minutes may be the time required to actually write a page. So, we have to spend as much time correcting a page. If we are spending 20 minutes for composing a page, it is worth spending 20 minutes more for correcting the page. Now, we have some samples which I will just mention to you, but we will show them later on so that we do not get distracted by these visuals, etcetera. One is, we have taken a download of the American Constitution, first page of American Constitution, so which later on you can see on the laptop. The first page has at least 2 errors, and before writing this final draft, they must have done many previous drafts which must be having many more errors. Despite that, they are having 2 errors, but which they have corrected. In fact, there are more than 2 errors, if you go through you will find, but there is no error which is left uncorrected. It is a handwritten document, so they could not have corrected it, it would have gone on and on forever. So, even they have lived with this. The other examples which I have from Saturday's Times of India, that is day before yesterday's, 2 days before today, Times of India. So, there are 3 kinds of errors in the same issue. So, those also I will show you, and when we describe these errors, you will see that all the errors occur. If one type of error occurs, you can be sure all types of errors will occur. So, they go together, all errors go together. And as Dr. Phatak was mentioning, that if you have syntax errors, there are likely to be semantic errors, because confusion in use of language means confusion in your thinking. So, one way to clarify your thinking is to learn the low end use of language, that is to master grammar. That is the first step for doing correct composition. Everybody concentrates on composition, but grammar is more important to start with. So, suppose there is a problem of this scale, why solve it? Because we have been getting along without that. We do not notice the error, we understand everything that is said, everybody else understands. So, what is the point in being 100% accurate? Why spend so much energy? One reason is, with globalization, there are no local standards, like what you are saying, Indian standards. The whole world follows these standards. The manual which you referred to, this is the Chicago Manual of Style. So, this is not published by a professional publisher, it is published by Chicago University Press, because when Chicago University Press was publishing books, they found that they should have a reference book for themselves. So, they published it as a small book. Then it became so popular that everybody else, including publishers, requested them that you publish it as a regular book. So, it was first published in 1906, the first edition, which was only few hundred pages. By now, it is probably 700 pages. This is the 16th edition which we have got, and this also contains references to electronic publishing, that is whatever is published in any medium. So, anywhere in the world you go in English speaking countries, they will be following the Chicago Manual of Style, and in this all the clauses are listed like legal clauses, that 2.1.6, etcetera. You can refer to the clause number and anybody can find it in his manual. So, there are no disputes about use of language. So, one reason is, if we want to globalize and if we want to attain our position in the world, then we have to reach world standard, whether we like it or not. So, we have to catch up. If English is not our mother tongue, or we are not properly taught it, that is no excuse. We have to catch up. And now, the kind of work which we are doing, like this distance education program or MHRD project, whatever we are publishing will be widely disseminated, not only in India, but all over the world. So there will be 100,000 people having a look at these documents. So it is far more important that whatever goes out of here is well formatted, that nobody should be able to point out. If you observe any foreign books, you will never find an errata and you will never find an error in any official publishing. You might have read report that standard of language is going down everywhere, which is true. Even in their schools and colleges, standard of language is going down. Even students over there cannot write properly. But there is a small elite which does the publishing, which publishes academic papers, which writes books, which has kept the standard high. So that English is called as edited English, compared to just written English or typed English. This is called edited English, and edited English always follows rules like the Chicago Manual of Style. You might have all read articles in Wikipedia. Wikipedia is a purely voluntary organization. Even if they make mistakes, you can't catch them because you are not paying for it. But you will find that even Wikipedia articles are very well written because they have a team of proofreaders at the background, which is always doing proofreading for this, even if they are not authors themselves. And you will find that those articles are as good as any commercial publication because they have kept that standard, even though it is a voluntary effort. Now, what is the percentage of errors, or how many errors are there really? Means, are we arguing about some small thing, or there are significant number of errors? You will find that there are in instructions to authors in all the publications, it says the manuscript or typescript should be typed on one side of the sheet and it should be double spaced. Have you read this anywhere? This is the first line in any instruction to authors. So why double spaced? Why leave a blank line between each line while submitting the typescript? Can anybody say? Yes. If there are errors, they should be marked in that spot itself, on top of the line. But if there are going to be few errors, say one or two errors per line, you can always mark them in the margin. Why leave a whole line for that? That means there can be as many errors as the line potentially. You leave so much space that whatever be the number of errors, even if you have to rewrite the whole line, there should be enough space for that. So that indicates that when you start with a manuscript or typescript, there are lot of errors. It assumes that there are going to be lot of errors. So you leave one line blank in between. So this is incidentally the first thing we should follow whenever anybody submits a typescript for checking. It should always be double spaced. It should not be just an ordinary printout for checking. The first manuscript must be double spaced. Typically, if you take an A4 size page which has 30 lines and 300 words, each line will have average one error as typed. So page will have roughly 30 errors. Average, some lines will have 2 or 3 errors. There may be 4 or 5 lines contiguously which have no error. But average there will be one error per line. So this does not really sound very much. But a typical book may be about 300 pages long. So how much is 300 into 30? 9000. It means the whole book will contain 9000 errors. And someday somebody is going to find out some error. If there are 9000 errors lying around, and there are going to be thousands of readers, someday somebody is going to find out and feel bad about it. So in first pass, when this is submitted, the errors get reduced, and they will get reduced to roughly between 3 and 1 error per page, because this was 30 errors per page. From that you can divide by a factor of 10 or factor of 30. So you will, if you turn the pages after first check and reprinting, then you will find 1 to 3 red marks on each page. still in a 300 page book sheet means 300 to 900 errors. So, these errors have to be corrected, then it will be one error in 10 pages. Finally, it will be ideally zero errors in 300 pages, but so few errors that most readers will not detect it. At that stage, this is tough because nobody will ever know whether we have zero errors. When it becomes few, then they are just noted down, and during next edition, those errors are corrected. Normally, if there are few errors in a book, then errata is not attached, because that is more distracting, because then people think that you might, there may be other errors which you have not found. If you have, these are the errors you have listed, so errata is not attached, and you will find that no foreign book has errata, maybe over the last 50 years. Indian books also do not have errata, but they do not check for errors. Now, you go back and read Indian books after you have learned this, and you will find out how many errors are there, and nobody even bothers to attach an errata. So, there are lot of errors even in a 2 or 4 page document like the kind of handouts we give. There will still be so many errors, there will be 50 to 100 errors in that document, and we have to correct them. Now, question is, suppose there are 9000 errors which have been marked on the proof. Why do not we correct them and print out, and the final version becomes ready? Why do you have to do it repeatedly? Practically, you will find that you have to do it repeatedly. So, what happens that you cannot really remove, even if you have seen all the errors, they do not get removed in one pass. Reasons are twofold. One is, detecting errors is itself a process, and any process is prone to errors. That means, error detection is also prone to errors. So, you can never hope to detect all the errors, especially if there are a large number of them, then they obscure your mind so much that some errors pass unnoticed in the first pass. That is why after the first pass, you have to correct all the errors and print out again without any markings. Then when somebody reads, preferably somebody else reads, that person will find some errors. That is the residue which I said, that there will be 1 to 3 errors per page still, but they would not have been found out in first pass, because they were being obscured by 30 more errors. Similarly, when the errors come to 1 in 10 pages, etcetera, then somebody has to read really carefully, looking for errors, and he will still find errors. That is why this has to be done in multiple passes. Whatever amount of effort you spend in first stage, you can never hope to do it in one stage. It has to be done repeatedly. And since if the same person is doing it again and again, then he will be making the same kinds of error detection errors. So, he will miss the same errors. So, ideal is that each proof should be read by a different person. So, one reason why we have collected a group and are addressing it is that we have to make groups in each department where this manuscript will go around. Somebody will do the first correction, correct them, print out, then hand over to somebody else who hasn't read it. That person will be able to find the few remaining errors. Finally, for final polishing, it should go to somebody who doesn't know anything about this document, for whom this is a fresh document, and if that person says everything is okay, then you can send it for publishing. But same person checking and doing it again and again, you can't find all the errors. So, you need collaboration and you need group activity for this. That is why all the markings which we are learning, they cannot be individual markings which only you understand. They have to be such that they are understood by everybody else, and they are understood by everybody in the world, because what these markings are, they are independent of language. Even if you are doing Marathi or any other language, same markings hold, they are more like graphical markings. So, that is why we have to learn these markings. So, the process of publishing goes like this, that the author has some idea and he puts it down on paper. He might do some doodling, etcetera, or he might make small patches, do cut and paste, but finally, he will submit a manuscript which is not patchy. The manuscript submitted should not have say some stapled chit or something pasted to that, etcetera, something written in margin, this is not allowed, and nothing should be written on the back. So, if it is like this, then he should rewrite it or retype it so that it is well formatted. So, the author is supposed to check it first himself, and nowadays, since author is himself the typist, then that person should correct it at that stage itself and submit a manuscript as free as possible from errors, whatever the author can make out. That is the first step in this. Many times authors assume that the proofreader will take care of everything, and they do a shabby job and submit. Then the errors keep on remaining. So after this, this is called the manuscript, or MS, capital MS is called manuscript. Now manuscript is really written by hand. Nowadays it is not written by hand. We can call it typescript or print script, but technically it is called a manuscript. In proofreader's term, this is called copy. What is submitted by the author is called a copy. This is a technical word. It has nothing to do with xeroxing, etc. So the person who checks the manuscript submitted by the author is called a copy editor. He is not the final proofreader. So copy editor has a higher job to do, because he has not only to check for author's grammatical errors, but he has to check for content, whether author has given references correctly, whether there is consistency in the manuscript, whether some things need to be checked, some references need to be checked. All this is seen by the copy editor. That is why copy editing is considered a separate occupation. After copy editor makes his comments on the manuscript or typescript, it goes back to the author, and he will authorize the changes, because if there are content changes, then the author has to be kept aware. You can't change anything without the author's consent. Even an editor will not change anything unless the author consent. That is author's privilege. So the author will say that this is okay, whatever changes you have submitted to me, I accept. Then the final manuscript, corrected manuscript, will be ready. So author is supposed to keep one copy of this corrected manuscript with him, so that later on if there is a dispute that he had agreed to this or not agreed to this, he has a copy for reference, and he submits one copy of that back to the publishing department. Then it is typeset. The first copy, we have no clue of how the final book or publication will look. It is just in running script. But now when it is typeset, it is typeset near the final form. Nowadays the word processing software allows you to do everything by yourself. So you choose the final page size, font size, whether one column or two column, right justify, left justify, and try to set it as close as possible to the final format. Because if you assume that just now you will not right justify, you will do it later after correcting, you will find that after you justify, something happens, like hyphens appear because of word break, or original hyphens vanish because the word comes in one line, but the hyphen remains because the software does not know that the word has entered a new line. Even in newspapers, you will find that there are hyphens where there are word breaks where they are not required, because originally somebody submitted, at that time the line was ending there. When it was set to newspaper columns, it came in one line, but the hyphen remained. So you should make it as close as possible to the final format, so that after that formatting changes will not occur. Then this is called the proof now, and this is checked by the proofreader. Now author is not involved. So this is checked by the proofreader, or by multiple of proofreaders, till you make a final version and send it back to the author, because finally author has to have a look, because something might have happened in between while correcting, and the author has to okay it finally. This is the procedure outlined in this also, and in their case, how much time proofreading will take, the editing department has to give an estimate when they are given a manuscript, that it will take so many man hours and so many days till your final proof will be available for publishing, because they have publishing dates and they have a reverse count from there, that if you want to publish on this date, then at what time you should have this available. And the author again keeps one copy of this and submits one copy to the publisher. Author has to authorize that all errors have been corrected, even though he is not doing it himself. After that, if errors are found and publisher incurs some cost for reprinting, that is subtracted from author's remuneration. It is not a free for all. The author is responsible for publishing also. That is the international method. So, previously how they used to do this before, say, printing, because printing is only few hundred years old. So, previously in our language like Sanskrit, it was called Pandulipi. The draft is called, in Marathi it is called Pandulipi. What Pandulipi means? Pandu means white. You must have heard of Raja, King Pandu, who was white. So, Pandulipi means white writing, because normal writing on paper is black on white. So, what is white writing? That is a writing on a blackboard or writing on a stone or floor. There you cannot use a dark chalk, you have to use a white chalk. So, that is called Pandulipi. So, what they used to do is, whenever a poet or whoever had thought up something, he would not put it to paper, because paper was very expensive. So, he would first write it out on a either a board or a slab or a slate, if you have used slates. Slate is a black stone which school children use. He used to write on a slate, then he would check whether what he has written is correct. Then he would transfer it to paper. That was the method used in the past. So, at every stage the technologies have been different, but people have faced the same problems and they have solved it. Now, despite this, suppose you make a mistake in writing, now what do you do? So, the ink used in those days, right up to 50 years ago, was a pigment based ink. It was more like a paint. Once you write with that, it is difficult to remove it. The inks that you are using today, they are all holy colors, means they are water soluble inks. If you put the paper in water, all the ink will vanish. But in those days, removing ink was very difficult, because it was designed to last for centuries. So, they used to put a yellow pigment on, like you put whiting nowadays, you have white correcting fluid, because our papers are white. In those days, the papers were not white, paper used to be yellowish like this color. So, they used to use a yellow pigment called hartal, which is arsenious sulfide, which is a mineral, so it does not degrade, otherwise if you use turmeric or something, that will degrade. They used to put that on the wrong portion and overwrite on that. So, in Marathi there is a figure of speech called hartal faste, means if you cover something up, something which is legible, if you cover it up, it is called hartal faste. That comes from here. That comes from manuscript editing. So, they used to put this, after it dried, they could write on that with the ink. We will go to the sheet which you have and see the signs which are used for proof editing. So, these are called proofreader's marks. At present, when we do not know about these marks, we generally do it intuitively, so that the other person somehow understands what we mean, what correction is required. But once you use these marks, it becomes unambiguous and anybody will not make mistake while reading those marks. So, this page is incidentally from Chicago Manual of Style. I purposefully used this format. There are many other versions available, because this book will be available in our book collection. This will be always available for reference. That is why we have used this format. So, you can see that there are three types of marks. One are called operational signs, that is left most column. right column top is typographical signs and bottom is punctuation marks. So, operational signs are mostly related to the format of how the page will look. So, if you are reading the page, then you will not come to know what operational signs will be, they will not affect you. But if you look at the page, then and if you want to correct it, you will need operational signs. The typographical signs are especially required for languages like English, which are capital and small. They also have italics, bold, underline. So, those features which are referring to typography are indicated here. This also does not come in spoken language, because while speaking you do not speak in capitals or do not speak in underlines. It is only in written matter that this comes. And the remaining last is punctuation marks. So, today we will be studying 3/4 of this. We will just go through these marks, but we will not be using them today. In our exercise we can use them, but we do not really know how to use commas today. So, we will go one by one. The first is called delete. This sign is a small delta, handwritten delta, Greek delta, like we write del in calculus, etcetera. So, it is purposefully written as delta, because if you write D, then somebody will put D over there while typesetting English, while nobody will put delta over there, because they are not typesetting Greek. So, this Greek delta is used. Then this vertical brackets is close up or delete space. Sometimes there is extra space, unnecessary space. Then this sign above and below the line tells you that you close up this space. Below that is combination of the above two, that is delete and close up. That is, if the word has an extra letter inside and if you just say delete, then there will be a gap over there. If you just delete that, the gap will not close automatically. So, this says that when you delete the letter, you also close the gap and join the word together. So, this only happens when it is inside. And if a whole word is deleted, then you or a whole sentence or paragraph is deleted, you just run one line through in center of the line. You do not have to write delete. Whatever is crossed out is deleted. Then suppose you have made some correction and you realize that you should not have made this correction. Now what do you do? So, there is an undo. This is called state. That is, whatever correction you have made, you ask it to be ignored, because you cannot remove the correction. So, state means let it stay. In Latin it means let it stay, let it stand. State means let it stand. Then this hash sign means insert space. Suppose words have become very close together, then you put a vertical line there and put hash, that you put space here. Make space between words equal is not applicable nowadays, because the software does it. This is from typographical old typesetting days. Next are also not applicable. Insert hair space, letter space is only for typesetting. This inverse P with a double vertical column, this means begin new paragraph. This is a paragraph sign. If there is a running matter and you ask a new paragraph to be made at some point, then there you put a vertical line and put this sign that you make a new para here. The remaining move right, move left, these are also obvious, because the text might be haphazard, and if you want it to be aligned, then these four signs are there: move right, move left and center. Center means sometimes title etcetera goes to one side and you want it to be centered, then you give this sign. This means you center the title. Similarly, move up, move down are also related to that. Then flush left, flush right. Because if indentation, this flush left, flush right has not been done, typically in modern documents only flush left is used and right is kept free. So, depending on your application, that looks awkward. Sometimes you have to justify from both sides. So whichever side you want to justify, you can say flush left and flush right. Straighten type and align vertically is not relevant any longer. Transpose means you interchange. Typically, two adjacent letters will get interchanged while typing. Same happens in typesetting. So then you write transpose there, you mark that, and in fact there is a sign like this which we will see later, which says that you interchange these two. This happens with two words also. Sometimes grammatically you want the word order to be changed, then you just put this sign and say transpose. So you interchange the words. Spell means spell out. This is especially true of modern writers because everybody is fond of using short forms. But in professional publishing, short forms are not to be used. If you use a valid short form, then you have to declare, and if it is unfamiliar, the first time it occurs in your document, you have to declare it that this means so and so. You have to give the full form right at the beginning, otherwise the reader is confused that what this means. And informal short forms are not allowed. You have to spell out everything. You have to spell out numbers sometimes. So this SP means spell out, that you spell out in full. Typographical signs is set in italic type. Italic means inclined type, what we call, and Roman is what we normally use, that is straight type. So sometimes you want to convert Roman into italic, sometimes you want to convert italic into Roman. Italic is normally used to emphasize a word, that the word has a different meaning, or the reader should concentrate on that. Normally underline and bold, though they are available in word processing, is not used in professional publishing. In fact, in fiction writing even italic is not used. You won't find italics used in any fiction. Which word has emphasis is from the context, that is author's skill. If you have to use external devices to show the reader what is important, that means the author has failed. So boldface type set in lowercase, set in capitals and set in small capitals. These are all referring to Roman script. Wrong font set in correct type. Sometimes in between the font gets changed due to some wrong keystrokes or something, and then it persists. Then the author has to be alerted that the font has changed, and you go back to the correct font. These two signs are very important. This V and inverse V. This V means just insert, what we call caret mark for insertion anywhere, and it also means make a superscript, that if you want to put quotation marks or if you want to put apostrophe, and if you just put the apostrophe sign there, it could be on top of the line or bottom of the line. So if it is put inside this V, that means it is superscript or it is top of the line. Similarly, this is underscript, which is used for commas. It is also used for suffixes in mathematical writing, etc. If you want to come as a suffix, then you put this and put the letter there, that this should come as a suffix. Punctuation marks is what we will be using maximum. So insert comma is the inverse V. Two V's with one quotation mark going up, another coming down, is single quotation marks. They should always come in pairs like brackets. Sometimes people start with a quote mark and then forget to close it, like forgetting to close a bracket. So they will always come in pairs. It has been shown in pairs. Insert double quotation marks. Insert period. Now period is always at the bottom, so you don't have to specify it is at the bottom. But if you just put a dot there, it will get lost because nobody will make out. You put a dot and circle it, then it won't get lost. So insert period is this. Insert semicolon is clear. Insert colon is either of these two, because colon is both top and bottom. So either you put these pair of V's or just put line and colon. Hyphen m dash n dash are a bit advanced this thing, because normally we use hyphen for everything when there are dashes, but sometimes you want to separate some part of the sentence for emphasis, which can be done with a comma normally, but you can put a long dash called m dash so that it highlights that portion, and then again close with an m dash, because this m dash is again like a comma. So that is why this m dash means what, m dash and n dash, because the letter m is wider than letter n, because it has two arches. So m dash is longer than n dash, which is shorter and which is longer than a hyphen. There are many types of dashes available, they have to be judiciously used. So this is this sheet you have, this you can put up on the board in front of your computer or something. This will be always useful for reference till you get it by heart, and then you will know it intuitively. So we have an exercise, one page exercise. This we will be distributing to everybody. On the left, the line numbers are marked so that we know line by line what editing is being done. So when you get this, you write your name on top, because this will be your exercise. Then, because finally we want to do statistical analysis of how many errors are detectable. You can use a pencil or pen, whatever you have. Finally, when doing actual proof editing, you should use a red pen, preferably a red gel pen or ink pen, not a ball pen. So ball pen doesn't write small strokes etc. consistently, it becomes dry, it is meant for continuous writing. So for giving commas or such things, ball pen may not write properly, but if you use a pen with fluid ink like gel ink, then it will write properly. You should use a red pen, so that red markings stand in contrast to the printing which is normally black. Even in modern word processing softwares which provide the facility of editing online, they call this redlining. You might have seen that in Microsoft Word, if the software detects that the word you have spelt is not in its vocabulary, then it will put a wavy red line below that, and you can either acknowledge it or you can correct the word. This whole exercise is called redlining. The modern software allows you to add matter to that, and it will distinguish that. It also allows you to remove matter from that, but it doesn't use any of these marks. Traditionally, people still take a printout and do it on paper. Unless you are doing it at a distance, like concurrent editing or concurrent authorship, where you cannot meet the person, you cannot see the papers. If you are seeing face to face, it is better to use paper printout. It is easier to read on paper, it takes less time than reading on a video monitor. Has everybody got the sheet? Okay, so now you start from top, and first you just make a vague mark of where you feel there is a problem without bothering about which symbol to use. You make a small mark there with a pencil or something. After you have gone through, then you go over the detected errors one by one and try to use the corresponding symbol. At present, using the correct symbol is not very important. Detecting the error is more important. Symbols you will learn in the long run. So first you just go through the manuscript and mark the errors. Okay. Has everybody finished? Or more or less? You might still have doubts, but those will solve all the doubts when we show the solution on the screen. So anybody who has not finished and wants some more time, you can give some more time. Everybody has finished? Okay, now you put your name on top, and what you do is you just count the number of errors that you have detected, write them at the bottom and circle that number. If you have marked them also in the margins, then you have to sum the left margin, sum the right margin and sum both of them. Otherwise, you have to go line by line and count. Everybody has finished counting and written the score at the bottom. Anybody who has not? Everybody has finished. Now, what we will do is, we will take a quick survey. Since you know how many errors you have got. Okay, so now we will show the solution on this. You do not compare immediately with what you have done. You just concentrate on the solution. Okay, the first line is a heading. So it should be centered. It has gone to one side. So the comment says CTR is center. It also shows these both signs that you shift horizontally. And there is one more error, authors as proofreaders. The as A has to be small. In a title, normally all words have first capital. But if the words are non-functional words, like preposition, conjunctions, etc., then if it is less than 4 letters long, it is first small letter. Like Times of India, the of O is not capital. If it is more than 4 letters, like again, after or something, then it has to be first capital. This as is only 2 letters, so that A is small. Next. They are in sequence. By context, you identify. Lower capital, you have crossed the A. And LCM is lower capital can only apply to that. Centering is applying to the whole line. Then, next, this line has started towards right. It says flush left. The first sign says flush left. I do not care what kind of type you use for my book. This book has come out of the line. So it says push it to the right to align it with this. Said a myopic author to the publisher. Now here see the first line was a quotation. So it was into quotation marks. I don't care what kind of type you use for my book. The quotation is complete. Said a myopic author, you have come out of the quotation. Comma, then before but you should have quotation mark starting, because now again quotation is starting, because that myopic author is now again talking. But please print the galley proofs in large type. So after this full stop, the quotation mark has to complete. So quotation mark has come as pair over here. Perhaps in the future, such a request will not sound so ridiculous. This ridiculous has to be shifted towards right and aligned. Or you have to readjust the line so that there is no gap there. So will not sound so ridiculous to those familiar, it has become, it should be familiar. Spelling is wrong. So there is a caret mark and it says I on the left hand side, that is put I over there in familiar with the printing process, full stop, today. Now next sentence has started, so T has to be capital. So it says cap for T. Today, however,
type 1 set is not reset except EXEPCT. This should be EXCEPT. So, EP and C have to be interchanged. That is the interchange sign. This is the all the letters are there, but they are in wrong order. So, this EP has to go next and C has to come first. And it the margin it says TR is, that is transpose. That is a reminder that in this line something is to be transposed. That is interchange. Except to correct errors. Now, this after this there is a 1. What is this 1? This 1 refers to a footnote, because there is a footnote here which says 1. So, footnote you cannot write 1 in the same line, because otherwise it will belong to that line. You have to put this 1 as a superscript. V and 1 says that this 1 is superscript referring to the note. And this thought is completed here, so new para should start. So, below proofreading there is an L and this says para. You start a new para here. So, there is a new thought. So, proofreading is an art. Here this art has to be small, not capital. And craft was scratched out. The proofreader wanted to say only an art, but then he thought that and craft is important here. So, he has again put dot dot here and said state, that is let it remain, though he has cancelled it initially, let it remain. So, art and craft. All authors should know. Rudiments thereof. Now, here I think this marking is also wrong. It should be A should be crossed out. I should remain. A is crossed out there. Okay, in my copy it is. So, rudiments thereof. So, now once A is crossed, the word will break. We have to close it back. So, the symbol here shows delete and close up. In the right hand margin, it shows delete and close up. Rudiment thereof, comma, though no proofreader expects them to be masters of it. Now, watch proof. Now, what has happened is some fraction of line has got repeated and that is crossed out, because if you read like this, it would not make sense. The sentence will break, there will be some repetition. So, that proof. You eliminate this whole line, he has crossed this whole line and given one del for this, that you remove. It is understood that you will close up the vertical space once you eliminate a line, it is not separately shown. So, proof reader, you jump here, expect them to be masters of it. Watch not only for misspelled or incorrect works. Now, this works Microsoft Word will give you correct, because it is a valid word, but here it should be words. In misspelled or incorrect words, so K is crossed and it says D, that you substitute it by D. Often a most elusive error. Now, elusive is not correct, it is elusive, that which eludes you or escapes your attention. So, that I double L is crossed and it says EL, you substitute it by EL. Now, you see after incorrect words, the bracket starts. Often the most elusive error, that bracket has to complete, because brackets have to come in pairs. So, here it says that you put right bracket in left hand column, left of error it says you put right bracket, but also for misplaced spaces. Now this CED should be together because D is part of misplaced. So it says close up this, bring D closer to E and do not bring spaces also here. When you close the space, that spaces will also come here. So there you put a space. So in the right hand side it shows space. So second correction is space. First correction is close up the gap. Second correction is space. Third correction is unclosed quotation marks. Now D and E have become interchanged in closed. So it says transport. You make it CLOACD. Unclosed quotation marks and parenthesis. And improper, which should be improper. So again transpose, improper paragraphing, semicolon, and learn to recognize the difference between an M dash. What is shown here is M dash, which is a long dash, used to separate an interjectional part of a sentence. This part is complete, so another M dash, which is just below that, and an N dash used commonly between continuing numbers. Now it should be commonly used, not used commonly. So these both words should be transposed. Commonly should come first and used should come next. So it shows this symbol and transpose the word. Between continuing numbers. Now here at the end of this line there is a bracket complete, but the bracket has not started. So it says start the bracket here. So after numbers, start the bracket. E.g. PP means pages 5 to 10. When you want to show pages 5 to 10, you should use N dash, not M dash, not a long dash. This AND D should actually be AD, that is Anno Domini, that is what we call Isvisan 1165 to 70. So this A should be small capital, D should be small capital, AD is put in small capitals. So 1165 to 70 bracket complete. And the word dividing hyphen, between word and dividing there should be a hyphen. So these two lines show that there should be a hyphen there, two lines on left, so that between word and dividing there should be a hyphen. Whatever is underlined, this underlined is italic here, he says you put in Roman, means don't put italics. So it has circled this and says ROM is Roman script. In a MS, don't you think this should be in an MS? Yeah, yeah. So when it is spelt out, it doesn't start with a vowel. That's why it is a manuscript. MS is actually understood as manuscript. So it is a MS, not a an MS. Should, comma, of course be italicized in print. Now italicized, he has underlined and says italic. You italicize this word. Two lines drawn beneath letters or words indicate that these are to be reset in small capitals. So below small he has put two lines, which means you put this in small capitals. In the margin it says SC, that is small capital. After this there should be semicolon, because a new thought is starting, it is not just continuation of numbers. So semicolon, three lines indicate full capitals. Here the example itself should be in that font. So below full there are three lines and it says cap, that is full caps. capitals. Here the sentence has ended, so there should be a full stop, which is circled. Which is circled on the left. Now another parachute starts. It has put a symbol here on the right hand side. There is para marking. This next parachute starts. To find the errors overlooked by the proofreader is the author's first problem in proofreading. So in proof, proofreading should be one word. According to me, after author there should be an apostrophe, either after R or after S, if it is multiple authors. The second, the R is extra, so it says delete and close up. Second problem, problem is delete. Why? Because once you say first problem and when you say second, it is understood that it is problem. It's like you don't have to repeat the noun again. When you say first problem and when you say second, that means second problem is understood. It is actually it is the grammatical style is not good, because why you use pronouns, for example? Why don't you keep using the same noun? Because pronouns stand for the noun. So in a sentence, if a noun is once defined, then whatever is referred to as a noun refers to that noun. Till a comma or something comes, it is referring, you are talking about that noun only. Yes, you can write the second problem, it is grammatically correct, but it will be like a schoolboy. Is to make corrections using, corrections by using is more explanatory. Though corrections using will also make sense. So it says you write by over there. By using the marks and symbols devised, this Z should be substituted by S. Devised spelling is SED. By professional, this spelling is wrong because it is FESSIONAL, not double FE. So one F, it has said delete and close. And after S, you put another S for double SIONAL, professional proofreaders. Than any trained typesetter. This should be that any trained typesetter will understand. So N should be substituted by T. The third, this is now M dash. And most difficult, this M dash has to be closed. So another M dash here, this says M and dash below. And more, so because it wants to emphasize and most difficult, so it is put between two M dashes. So and most difficult, M dash, problem for authors proofreading their own works is to resist the temptation to rewrite in proofs. Now this is a bit technical. That manuscript editor should be caps and small caps. The E should be capital and ANUSCRIPT should be in small capitals. Now this is too technical. That is all. So now what is the total of this? Count left hand column and count right hand column. That's why it is marked in columns. So this, the actual errors in this are 50. We had about 25 minutes. We took about 25 minutes for the exercise. And it is asymptotic. Even if you take any amount of time, you won't have found more error than this. And our average score was 20, because 16 to 25 were maximum. So you can see that so many errors, if you read this paragraph without knowing that it is supposed to have errors, then you might get irritated that thinking that there are some errors maybe, but you won't think that there are 50 errors in this paragraph. This is what happens. And effect of badly proofread matter is that people understand the meaning, but they get irritated, especially if it's a long book or something. It is irritating. On the other hand, if it is well proofread, then you breeze through, because the brain doesn't recognize any errors. That is one more reason why good proofreading should be done, that readers find it convenient. Incidentally, this exercise is from this book. It is given in this book, only we separated out, in that it is printed along with this. So we made a copy without the markings, and if you observe this, this font is different from what is shown there. Have you observed it? What you are carrying is a different font. Which font is this? This is a serif font, and this is sans serif font. Does it look different from that? So this is handwritten. There was no way to separate these two layers. So it is handwritten by me. That's why it looks sans serif. Okay, so our exercise is over. You have got a taste of how proofreading is to be done. Don't feel bad about finding less errors, because everybody is at, but finding 20 errors is also not bad. So many people can't find 20 errors also. So you will improve with this, and you will reach a high level from here. Now these exercises we would like to collect, because we will do statistical analysis of this, and if you have any questions, I am here to answer them. So when I had told that typically it takes 20 minutes overall to correct a page, you experienced it. Though this is an artificial page, but even a normal page, and tomorrow we will start at 10 o'clock. We will be studying commas. That's why in today's exercise, if you have missed out commas or something, it is understood, because we haven't studied it formally. So maybe 5 or 7 errors will be those of commas. So first session again, we will study the background of commas. What is the meaning of commas? Why they are used, and when they are not to be used. Then we have tabulated all the uses, and we will be giving a handout of those, like we have this proofreader's marks, that you have a ready reference for commas. After that, you will be fully prepared, because you will know these marks as well as commas. Then in second session, we will do some exercises. Those exercises will not be as complicated as this, because this is an artificial exercise, but there will be more about commas, and I am planning to give you some live material, which is being written just now, which has come to me for proof checking. We will take that itself as an example, because it is not artificial, it is how people are composing just now. We will see how many errors we can find in that. So those we can do few pages of them, it won't be complicated. Okay, so thanks everybody. I hope you are able to use this knowledge, and if you do it in a group or in pairs, proof checking is fun. You will, once you do it, you will experience that proof checking is fun, and after you have cleared a manuscript of all the errors and you take a printout and compare with the original, then you will really feel like a fresh wind coming. When you read a corrected manuscript, it looks so different that you will enjoy yourself. Okay then, thank you and goodbye.